Hello all, our topic for today is energy band gap using Fourier method. So the aim of this topic is to find out the resistivity of any semiconductor sample and also to find out the energy band gap of that semiconductor sample. So we all know the two most commonly used semiconductor samples are germanium and silicon. Germanium has Eg of about 0.7 electron volt. So we'll proceed ahead and now see for our sample we will perform this experiment. So Fourier method, there are other methods also, but this is the most widely used method to measure resistivity and energy band gap in any semiconductor. The setup actually consists of a probe arrangement. So you have a sample substrate with four probes on it. Now these four probes should be equally spaced, so the distance between the points of any two probes should be the same. I'll name it as S. Other than this, obviously the probe arrangement, we also have the sample. So this is a sample here. It could be germanium or silicon. Then you have an oven which will help in increasing the temperature, because we'll study temperature against voltage. You need a power supply or a current generator, and current is applied across these two ends. So here I will apply my current to the outer two ends of the probes, and voltage is measured between these two. So current is what we will supply between the outer two probes, and voltage is what we will measure between the inner two probes. Obviously this measured voltage has to be displayed somewhere, so we have a digital panel. And obviously the oven also requires a supply. Now this sample is actually a very thin wafer. It is in mm, and this is spread out or deposited on a substrate. So you have a substrate material on which we deposit a layer of our sample, which is actually in mm. And as I said, this distance between any two probes should be equal. Secondly, this distance should be greater than the diameter of the tip of the probe. The reason being, if the diameter of the tip is more, then the probes will overlap. So to avoid that, this distance should be much greater than the diameter of the probes. And coming to resistivity, so initially we'll first measure resistivity. Now resistivity is basically the measurement of how difficult is it for electric current to flow through a device, substance or a semiconductor per unit length, per unit cross section area. So resistance is like something opposing the current flow, the measure of opposition of current flow. But resistivity is the measure of opposition to current flow per unit length, per unit cross section area. So that is why the relation between resistance and resistivity is like resistivity will give you the amount, the measure of your opposition into L upon A, where length, L is the length of your semiconductor device and A is the area. Now obviously you'll ask why L upon A. So as the distance increases, resistance increases because it becomes more difficult for current to flow from one end to another. But with area, resistivity decreases. Reason being, more area available for electrons to flow. So the electric current increases. So R is basically proportional to length of your device, because it has to pass that much length from one end to another. But with area, resistance decreases because more area for your electrons to free flow. So R is rho into L by A. Now you know R is nothing but V by I, Ohm's law. Rho is, I'll just leave it as it is. This length in our case, now suppose I say one side, I assume the sample is S. So if this is the sample, I'm not talking of substrate, I'm talking of the sample. So the sample is of length S, and so area will be given as 2 pi S square. This cancels out. So I get rho is nothing but 2 pi s into v by pi. Like I told you, we are supplying current, we are measuring voltage. If we supply current, we know the current, we'll keep the current fixed, we'll increase the temperature. So we'll note down V. Using this, I will know, the manufacturer will give you the dimensions of the sample, so you can calculate resistivity. Now coming to energy band gap. This is only the resistivity. Okay, before going to energy band gap, few things you need to keep in mind for your sample. Number one, the sample should be uniform throughout. Like the sample on the substrate should be uniform. It cannot be thin, you know, even if it's an mm, it can't be that at one point the deposition is more than the other. It has to be uniform. Second thing, the sample has to be flat surface and there can't be any leakages. By leakages I mean there can't be any holes in it. The third thing, the four probes have to be in a single straight line. You can't have the probes front and back because obviously maybe the substrate area is more compared to your sample area. And then one more thing is, I already told this point, the four diameters should be equal and also the S in each case should be equal. So now moving on to, we've calculated resistivity, we need energy band gap. So as temperature increases, you know that it is the flow of current increases. It makes it easier for electrons to move around and so electric charge increases, current increases. But since flow becomes easier, so with increase in temperature, what happens is there is a decrease in resistivity. Since as resistivity is opposition and temperature is making it easier for the charges to flow, so the opposition reduces. And this happens only in case of semiconductors. So this is an important relation we need to know. So we all know that rho is equal to rho naught e raised to Eg by 2kT. Okay, this is an equation for extrinsic semiconductors which you've been doing since I think your third year. So if you see, you get rho upon rho naught is equal to e raised to Eg by 2kT. If I take log on both sides, I will get log to the base 10 rho by rho naught is equal to Eg by 2kT. Since I want to calculate Eg, so I can write this as Eg is equal to 2k into log of 10. Let's say this is rho final. I want T in the denominator, so I can write this as T inverse. Why I want T in the denominator, I'll tell you. I have got temperature, I am already giving temperature, so I have this reading. So this is how our table will look like. We'll be giving temperature, then we will measure, we are giving a constant I, we will measure V. Using this we get rho and then we'll take log of rho to the base 10. So whatever rho this is, because that rho upon rho naught factor is taken care of here. So you need temperature inverse. From this I can get T inverse. I can plot a graph of log rho and T inverse. This will give me the slope. So I can write therefore Eg is equal to 2k times slope. So this is how, using this experiment, we first calculated resistivity and then using this resistivity and temperature, we get the energy band gap of our sample. So now let's move to the experimental setup. So this is the experimental setup. This is the oven. As you can see inside, this is a metallic plate inside. So we'll be heating that. Now here is a sample and these are the four probes which are equally spaced. So if you can see, this is probe 1, 2, 3 and 4. You can see how small is their diameter and what is the space between.
So I have kept the four probes in a linear manner on the sample. So we'll just put this sample in the oven. Coming to your setup here. So this RTD is the channel which connects your oven to the panel here. This is to heat the oven. So the oven will be given power supply or power generator from here for heating. Then you have your voltage pins and your current pins. Now this is the same digital panel which will give current and voltage. So if I want current, I'll keep this on the current bar, or else I can move it to voltage. And this is what will give me the temperature. This temperature will come in Kelvin. Okay, so that you have to keep in mind. So initially I've kept my oven on off, that means I'm not heating. I'll just put the supply on. I want to fix a constant current, so I can fix some constant current value as per my wish. So suppose I keep it at around 2. Okay, now keeping the current 2, let's move to voltage. Now after I'll note down my initial temperature and voltage, and I will start heating. First thing, keep in mind, this was in millivolts and milliamps. So again, if you want, you can make it around 2, but that doesn't make much of a difference. So this is around 2. Yeah, and now this is in milliamps and this is in millivolts into the range of 10, because when I go into 1, it may read now but later. So this is 171 millivolts, but once I start heating, this may go out of range. So we'll keep the range into 10, because the reading may go above 1000 millivolts, which is just 1 volt. So keeping it here, we'll start heating. Now there's also one thing called set temperature. So suppose you want to set your temperature, you don't want to go beyond 400 Kelvin. What happens is, you may just put it on and leave. You won't be sitting completely throughout here. So you can keep this on set temperature. So the minute it has reached that set temperature, the oven will automatically shut off. So this helps you from protecting from, overheating. So that this is the use of set temperature. Now since we are not going anywhere, so we may keep it at maximum, doesn't matter, because the minute I see the panel, I'll put the oven off. But for if you want to just set your temperature and go somewhere, then this comes into role, so that it will protect the oven from overheating. So I've put my oven on. This indicates that the oven is heating, and now you will see as the temperature increases, your voltage will decrease. So let's just view. This will take a little time. So now you can see, as our temperature is increasing, the voltage is decreasing. So we'll get a set of readings. You will keep going up to 400 in the gaps of 5. So we started with 305 because room temperature was 302. So 305, 310, 15, 20, so on up to 400. And you'll keep measuring the voltage, and then take the inverse, T-inverse, measure your row as explained in the theory part, and draw the graph and get the answer. So that's all for this experiment. Thank you.